Good afternoon and good morning, depending which coast or where you are in between. Welcome to our April's edition of 30 Minutes with Lynxspring, our monthly webinar series hosted by Lynxspring subject matter experts and special guests. I'm Tanya Peterson, product marketing specialist here at Lynxspring. We will be recording this webinar and we'll make it available to you, both the PowerPoint and a webinar link on our YouTube channel next week. In keeping with the theme of 30 Minutes with Lynxspring, we will do the presentation first and then take a few questions at the end. If you have any questions, please be sure to use the question function available to you. Today we are looking at performing a factory reset for PC-8000 and using Web Start. Jason Mayo, a member of our technical support team, will share best practices for performing a factory reset for a PC-8000 or a JACE-8000 and review using Web Start. When it comes to the PC-8000 or JACE-8000, the reset process is different than with legacy controllers. Previous versions of Niagara's JACE-8000 install startup guide have been revised and have led to changing the process slightly. Jason will cover the new procedure. When it comes to Web Start, we will show you what you need to know to launch a workbench environment outside of a browser. Now that the browsers have ended their support of Java plugins, the only way to run Niagara Workbench applets is locally using Web Start. Okay, Jason, let's get started.
Thanks, Tanya. So whether you're looking to restore the default conditions for an 8000 because of dealing with platform daemon passwords or passphrases, or you're just looking to decommission the controller, the process has changed slightly. Originally, the instructions were to hold the backup restore button for at least 5 seconds and then let go, but that didn't always work. So that process has been changed to account for the different delays that happen in that. The new procedure includes holding that button for not just for 5 seconds, it's actually after about 10 seconds, you're going to be thrown a message banner that indicates it, the controller has recognized your restore button back press. The difference here, you do have to make sure that you know it's powered off when you when you're connected to this with the terminal emulator, and you have to continue holding that button until you see this banner that shows that it was detected. Then once you get that banner, you can release that button. It is important to note down here that if you press any key during that 10-second countdown that it starts, you will prevent the system from doing the recovery mode. Instead, it will go into a USB backup mode. And then you'd actually have to stop that and start the whole process all over again. Another important thing to note, when you are in recovery mode, you'll know it because the backup LED flashes. And when you see that flashing, you do have to allow that to complete before you can end the process, or else it'll actually lock up the controller. It does take a little while after you do a factory reset for it to reboot. It's a little slower than any other time. It's already been commissioned. Kind of takes 2 to 5 minutes is what we're experiencing. So what do you need to do it? All you need is the USB to micro USB type A cable. It's the same one that's used in like Samsung phones. And then any kind of terminal emulator program, whether it's PuTTY or the one that's native to your PC through Windows or MOBA, Xterm, any of those are just fine. So how do you do it? You power the controller off and you connect to the debug port, which is under the lid of the 8000. The debug port is on that diagram number 5 that you can see. That's where you plug your USB cable into. And then the backup restore button is just above that to the left. It is important to note here that if you've ever converted an 8000 to run AX instead of N4, when you do this restore to default and you want to take it back to AX again, you'll still have to perform that procedure because it will default to having N4 commissioned on it. All right, so to continue with the steps, you'd launch that terminal emulator. Then you'll press and hold the backup button while you apply power. Once you see that message banner that the button press has been detected, Then you release the backup button. After that, the power will cycle and you will be able to connect your 8000. Moving on to our second topic, web start. We have a lot of questions about that lately, and we're experiencing new little gotchas all the time, so I wanted to make sure that we had the opportunity to kind of talk about those. So what is web start? Oracle has had web start available for quite some time now. It's native to everybody's Java runtime environment that they have on their PC. So it uses Java network launch protocol files instead of applets. So instead of exchanging applets over the browser, which now you can't, it exchanges JNLP files that are rendered as applets locally on your PC once it receives them. All you need to do to have web start is 38111 or the latest 4.2, which is .36. You do need to make sure that you have the license feature web UI equals true and the UI .wb equal true so you can launch web start. All right, using web start is really simple actually. When you in a browser, you're going to connect to the station using the IP address that you normally are used to using. And instead of logging in, you'll see below the login prompt that there's a little hyperlink for Java Web Start. You click that, and then the JNLP application will download to your machine. You can save it as a shortcut if you want on your desktop. That's what we normally recommend. And then every time you want to connect to this station remotely hereafter, you won't open a browser and enter the IP address. You'll just launch that native application that you just downloaded to your desktop. Some finer points to make sure that we talk about using Web Start would consist of making sure that we understand every station, remote station that you want to connect to, you have to download a new JNLP file and application for each one of those. So if you're managing 10 different sites or stations that you're going to be connecting remotely, you're going to have 10 of these icons on your desktop to access them. In most cases, it's good just to go ahead and clear your applet cache that you have on your machine. You'd need to do that in not just the Java cache, but also your user Niagara applet cache that's on your hard drive. We recommend you do that all the time. It just depends on which applet cache needs to be cleared or not. So we just recommend clearing all of them so you don't have any conflicts. There is a gotcha with using Web Start between AX and N4. So if you have an AX station that you're connecting to through Web Start, you'll need a separate one for the N4 if you have an N4 station. If you connect to a station that's running AX, you can't hyperlink then to an N4 station through graphics or anything like that, and vice versa. They'd have to actually be comparable. HTML and HX is not fully supported in Web Start, so if you're using either one of those profiles, there are some things that you'll run into that don't render correctly. HX is a little bit different. It'll render, but the behavior of your PX panes and how it's all laid out change dramatically. So you probably want to avoid using those two profiles as much as possible. In some cases, changes made to stations require a new JNLP file to be downloaded. We've noticed that if you're making significant changes or over a period of several hours, you made a lot of changes, you should go ahead connect over a browser and download a new JNLP file. To make sure that all the changes got reflected correctly. One other additional one I can think of would be if you're hyperlinking between stations remotely, there can be an issue using third-party drivers where if you have PX widgets that reference, like, say, COM4 network, and you don't have that COM4 module on the initial application that you launched. So if you're using, like, say, a supervisor station, you're connecting to its subordinate station. If the subordinate station has that third-party driver, but the supervisor station does not, and there's a reference to it in a PX graphic at all there, you will need a copy of that module in that case, the supervisor's repository, for that to render correctly. It's really as simple as that. Does anyone have any questions?
Hey, Jason, here's a question for you. When or why would you use web start for N4?
If you're not using HTML, so N4 uses HTML natively, which escapes the whole issue for using applets, but in some cases you can use non-HTML files in N4 only when you're hyperlinking, though.
Okay. Jason, as you work with our wonderful customers, what are some other questions that might come your way in these regards?
Licensing comes up a lot. And then, of course, the versioning for using WebStart. And then lately, we've even had lots of questions about how many stations they can connect to using one application of WebStart. So it just depends on how you want to do that and how easy you want to make it for your customers, depending on how many stations they need to manage. But you know, one weird one that we kind of started exploring is how many hops through the different stations we can do with one application of WebStart, and how that might change behavior of anything.
Okay. Any other examples you'd like to share with us?
I think I covered the bulk of the ones that we're aware of now. I'm sure there's other applications that we're just not aware of yet.
All right. And if we don't have any more questions from you guys, we'll go ahead and end this April's session. So in conclusion, we hope you've enjoyed a little shortened version of today's webinar. Please mark your calendars for next month's 30 Minutes with Lynxspring, which will take place on Wednesday, May 17th. We'll have more information forthcoming, and you guys have a great day. Thanks.